Welcome everybody to my second lecture here on Ostrita. Today what we're going to do is we're going to basically talk about the big myths surrounding sales. Me personally, I've been working in sales for over a year now as a sales manager. And also, like, it's not only my experience. The company I work for provides me with a whole lot of trainings, a lot of like lectures from more experienced people. Read a bunch of books, for example, Influence by Cialdini. I've also read Wave the Wolf by the man himself, by the Wolf of Wall Street, Jordan Belfort. And finally, the one I enjoyed the most, and I think is the most accurate, and actually which helped me the most, is probably Never Split the Difference, I would say, by Chris Voss. Okay, so basically what we're gonna do in this thing is, as I've already told you, there are a lot of myths surrounding sales. Like, it's probably the one thing that's most, the one like business field, I would say, which is most stereotyped of all the different fields, like along with finance probably, or maybe like advertisement. But the thing is, I've in this year that I've worked for there, I've kind of been steadily keeping finding out how much things don't really make sense, how much things completely different from the real thing. And usually they fall into four different categories. I call them the Leo, the debate, the cost benefit game, and the sleaze. And the reason why I think that it's very important for you to watch this is sales is basically everywhere. Even if you're not doing sales, like, I see so many people, like, for example, starting their own business or like their own practice, for example, let me say, a little shop, a little like barber's place or something, barber station. And of course you need to do some sales for that. Also, when you're working for like a study council, you also need to do some sales just to get people on board with your ideas. And the thing is, usually they do it very, very wrongly because of this stereotype they got in their head of what a good salesman should be like. So yeah, I'm gonna debunk all of them right away. Okay, first of all, probably the biggest of them all, the Leo, it's often called, basically from Leonardo DiCaprio in The Wolf of Wall Street, the guy who portrays the actual Jordan Belfort, from which I read the book. The thing is, like, look at this picture right here. This right here is the first image you get on Google Images when you type in salesperson or sales guy, and you pick the one that isn't watermarked. It's amazing how everybody kind of has the same notion of what a real salesman is like. It's always, you know, preppy, white guy, well-shaven, suit and tie, that kind of stuff. Sticking his hand out like, hey, come on, give me a hand. Let's close the deal, right? You know? And the thing is, it's completely, completely wrong. Because the thing is, something you should always remember is a salesperson, a good salesperson, doesn't look like a good salesperson. That's the whole point. I see so many times when someone, like a young person, tries to sell something, they usually like have this idea, because it's always portrayed on television, if I just show myself to be, have real confidence and just completely, you know, lean forward and pack them in, and that will be magic, and then they'll fall for my tactics and they'll buy everything I want. The thing is, it really, really doesn't work like that. Everybody, especially nowadays, especially since we've all seen those movies, see a guy like this and not very consciously, but very much unconsciously, alarm bells start ringing. Like, oh my God, I shouldn't trust this guy. Look at him. Like, he definitely, you know, he smells money. That's what you think when you see this guy. So the thing is, the antidote, like the cure for this, is you got to remember, people want to buy stuff. They really want to. It's not your task to make them want to buy stuff. They already want that. You just don't want stuff getting sold to them. And this is the thing. People travel to faraway places. People travel, like, there's in the Netherlands. We got like two places, like Fashion Valley, which is kind of like close to Roosendaal and Breda. And also like Veenendaal, for example, people travel from far and wide to those places to go to the big shopping halls, to go to the little, you know, boutiques and everything, just because they want to buy stuff. People love that. People really enjoy it. It's like one of the reasons why people love money so much, because they're just really, really happy to be able to buy things. But the thing is, when you walk past a restaurant, you know, and it looks amazing, you see a big line of people, that draws your attention. Then you think like, okay, I want to be there. Oh my God, line sucks, but I want to be there. But when there's like no line, and you see a guy come up to you like, hey, do you wanna eat at our restaurant? You already know like, oh, this isn't gonna be good. So that's the thing. You don't make people want to buy. You don't make people want to buy. They already want it. You don't sell anything to them. Basically what you just do, you don't lean in. You basically just notify them. You basically just tell them like, okay, hey, no problem. You don't need to buy anything from me. It doesn't matter to me. Like, I'm good already. Just create this atmosphere of it's all gonna be okay. There's no problem. And basically just say like, okay, but if you buy this and this and this is are the benefits, and just make all the action come from them. And that way you have such a stronger basis. Then the second thing, and I see this mostly with young people, the debate. And basically this just doesn't make any sense when you really think about it, but everybody seems to be doing it. Basically what the debate is, and as I already said, like young people, young professionals starting out, they usually do this thing. They tell you like, hey, do you wanna shop with me? Do you want, for example, a subscription from me? Do you want to, let me just pull out an example. Somebody saying like, hey, I sell custom-made hoodies, for example. I've once had that occur to me. And he asked like, hey, do you want to buy it? And I said, no, I don't really want to buy it. And then he started saying like, okay, you sure? Because like, they're not that expensive and you're going to buy hoodies anyway, I think. So why wouldn't you buy it from this? And I'm like, you know, I'm a student, so I don't want to, you know, click to anything. And that guy was telling me like, okay, well, we also donate 5% of what we do to charity, to the environment. Don't you want to make the world a better place? And like those kind of things, you see, they're basically like trying to corner you and trying to think like the whole premise of it all, the baseline is, if I can just logically debunk every argument from the guy that I'm trying to sell to, he's eventually going to say, well, you know, you're right about all those points. Yeah, okay, I'm gonna buy it. But that never, ever happens. Because here's the rule. Here's the debunker. You don't always buy something if it feels good. That's not the rule. But you never, ever buy something if it doesn't feel good. If you're not smiling, if your customer is not smiling at you, he's like, okay, you're kind of right. Okay, I'll buy it. That never happens. The only time, because always, this is the thing that always happens. People put something up that we call a smokescreen. That's basically like a sales jargon for an excuse. Basically, someone will start to say things like, I'll do it, but give me a link, for example, so I can sign up on the website, or I need to consult somebody first, or I need to first manage my finances. And if I do that, then I will send you a message and we can get this thing rolling. And I never get back on it, because basically, this is the way the brain works. When you corner somebody, he's not gonna make commitments. He's basically, if it doesn't feel right, if you're like at the front of the head, this prefrontal cortex, people usually very crudely say that that's where conscious decisions are being made. That doesn't affect that much of your eventual decision, because you got so much of your brain left. It's basically just a feeling that you got from something. And if you just feel like, okay, this isn't really right, you're always like, it's instinct, you're gonna try to escape. So what you should do is don't debate with the customer. That never ever works. Make them feel good. Don't ever square up to them. Never, you know, never place yourself straight onto them, look them in the eye, kind of be intimidating. Sometimes people do that, but it never ever works. You know, make them feel at ease. Stand a bit shoulder to shoulder. Make them laugh a little bit. Be like, okay, no pressure. You can buy it. If you want to, you can buy it. If you don't want to buy it, no problem. And that creates an environment in which people really can start to consider, do I actually want this? And as I already told you, in like the Leo, people usually want to buy stuff. So if you can just really make the clear the playing field, then that is, it doesn't always work in terms of getting, in terms of closing a sale. But if you start baiting with them, you start squaring up to them, that I can guarantee you, like, that guy is going to be crazy if he actually buys something from you then. Then the next big, big misconception, the cost-benefit game. People usually think of it, sales, as this kind of game in which you are trying to optimize the sales, the sales volume, you usually call it, so like the amount of sales for your company or for yourself if you're, you know, doing personal sales. But the thing is, it doesn't work like that. It's not a game in which two people come together and basically start, you know, playing chess in a kind of sense, because a lot of people think that when you, for example, before a company started doing sales, you meet another sales representative or a decision-making representative, and basically you're just gonna puzzle your way out and give some good arguments and play a bit of mental chess, and eventually you'll be the guy who reaps the most benefit out of it, or he'll be the guy who reaps the most benefit out of it, depending on who's the better one, who's better at sales. But it's not at all like that, and people should really understand that, because it really puts such a different light on it when you know it actually goes. Usually when people do marketing, for example, especially in business, the business-to-business marketing is a great and great example of this. When people talk to each other on that level, usually like 10% is about the actual product, because on the whole, it is far and far more a trust game. A lot of companies don't really care that much that they're getting the best deals possible. That's not really how it works. People just want a partner who they can trust, who is reliable. And in that sense, it is so much more important to, when you meet somebody and you come do sales, that you don't have that notion in your head that you're going to play mental chess, but, you know, be kind to him. Just ask him, hey, how's it going? How are you? Basically maintain a relationship between you two, because that's where the relationship of the both companies is built upon, and your relationship of the sales representatives. So yeah, show a little trust. It's on every level. It's on that big level I was just talking about, but also smaller levels. People, when it's just person to person, when a good friend of mine, for example, opens a restaurant, of course I'm gonna eat there. I'm not gonna question like, oh, is the food good and those kind of things. No, because eventually it's not that much, you know, cold hard business. A lot of it would really surprise you how much it's actually friendly on this level of, yeah, maintaining relationships, which also kind of makes sense, because otherwise it wouldn't work. You gotta have that friendliness to actually build the trust. And then the last thing, and it's probably the biggest misconception of them all, basically the sleaze, this idea that a businessman should be a little bit sleazy, a little bit unethical. That's usually what people say, like, for example, basically like on the verge of a con man. Like, it's not really a con man, but it's tending to that. And the thing is, it really, really, really doesn't work like this. And people should really learn that. It's probably a lot because of like movies like The Wolf of Wall Street or The Sting, for example, or those kind of things. But really, really, it doesn't work like that. Basically what it is people always think that if you're going to be a salesperson, and also like people are kind of right in that sense also, because a lot of salespersons do this very wrongly, and they kind of see themselves also as a bit of a sleazebag because they're in the field, but it doesn't have to be like that. And the thing with that is, what you should be eventually, when you think about it, when you actually go down, tunnel into what you're actually doing, what you do is you're a problem solver. Basically what the real job of a salesman is, when you're a salesman there, you basically have this idea that there are a ton, like a million solutions in the world, and there also are a million problems in the world, as we all know. And what you do as a salesperson is you connect to the right people and then try to solve those problems with already existing solutions. That's basically what being a salesperson comes down to. And it's not about, you know, picking just any customer and basically just saying like, okay, if I'm good enough, if I'm charismatic enough, I can sell this product to them. That's not what it's about at all. That's also the best salespeople in the world will tell you that. It's not that people always have this thing like, it's even like, how do you say it? It's even a proverb, like being able to sell ice to an Eskimo. Well, that's not what a salesperson is about. Being a salesperson, also the very best salespersons in the world, they wouldn't want to sell ice to an Eskimo. They're just really good at finding the right people who actually would need the ice, you know, like people living in the desert or something, not the Eskimos. And that's the big thing. You are a problem solver. You are a person who basically spots opportunities for someone who has a problem, and you say, okay, I know a certain solution. I can bring you two together, and that's where I get my money from. Basically, a very important thing to remember this is the actual terminology used in business. Basically, the complete body of like everyone in a company or organization that eventually is responsible or has something to do with the buying process, that's called the decision-making unit. So they're not, it's not about buying, it's about making decisions. That's in business, that's the same thing, buying something or making a decision, because it always costs resources when you make a decision. And then the complete body of like another organization that eventually sells something is not called a selling unit, but it's called a problem-solving unit. So basically in business, people already understand this, but a lot of people who are outsiders don't know this. Basically, it's not a game of swindling or anything. It's basically just a way of, you know, solving a problem and letting someone else make the decision either to accept your solution or not to accept it. And yeah, that's what it all comes down to. And then eventually, in conclusion, yeah, all those things taken together, people just think it's kind of like swindling sales. It's this thing where you tell a lot of people to basically say like, oh, okay, my product is the best, and it's like a lying game. That's the thing where it all comes down to. People think that being good at sales is synonymous with being good at lying, but it really isn't. As I already told you in the second part, in the debate thing, people usually, they might not consciously know if you lie to them, but if you lie to someone, you always usually find out that the feeling is gonna be a little bit tense. Like people might not know it, but they get a little bit of a tense feeling in themselves, and that's also like doesn't benefit the sales. So basically, just as a really strong bottom line, ditch that complete idea that you're gonna be a liar and just focus on being effective, on finding people that need their problems being solved, and also knowing the right solutions to that, and then just combining those two, because that's what you really are. So yeah, that's basically what this whole presentation comes down to. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you the next time.